As an archaeologist, we know that the past is fragile and deteriorating. It doesn't matter whether it's British heritage, it's Egyptian heritage, it's New Zealand heritage. These things do not survive, and that's just the nature of it. So everything we do is about conservation, recording and preserving as much as we can for the future.
There's a huge amount of material that's preserved by the desert sands, by the climate. With the tourist industry, of course, people very rightly want to see as many of these monuments as they can, and that inevitably puts a lot of pressure on some of the monuments.
I think it's our duty to the material to consider it an act of urgency to record as much as we can.
The Griffith Institute was founded 75 years ago, and it's named after the first professor of Egyptology, Francis Llewellyn Griffith. And he set up a library and also research projects that were trying to gather together a bibliography of everything published about ancient Egypt.
Howard Carter was a very talented artist who'd been working in Egypt for some years, and he was the person that most famously discovered the tomb of Tutankhamun in 1922. And we have the majority of those records here.
The tomb of Tutankhamun was built by extremely skilled craftsmen to last for eternity, but it was never ever meant to be visited. And what happens when 1,000 people a day go into a space that was never meant to be visited? I'm not an Egyptologist nor a conservator, so our job is to provide data and information. Most of the work we do is in the tombs, is devoted to digitizing it, different kinds of data, from three-dimensional to color to x-ray to infrared, historical photographs. So that's my relationship with the Griffith Institute here.
The primary resource was the Burton photographs. Burton was an incredibly gifted photographer who Carter managed to involve in the tomb's discovery, and he produced these incredibly, incredibly detailed records of all the objects and the tomb walls and the tomb environment. Factum Arte were able to use the photographs to reconstruct scenes that had been damaged by the excavation process.
We can rematerialize it physically with the qualities of the original object. It's an exact portrait of the tomb of Tutankhamun in 2009. When I say exact, it's probably exact to a fifth of a millimetre.
In order to create the replica, the recording work they were doing in the original tomb gives us a conservation record that is unparalleled.
We're at a point where we can enter a whole new phase to really reinvent Griffith's vision of making all these resources about an ancient culture fully accessible across the world with digital means.
A lot of objects that we consider real have already been extensively restored, have been taken out of their context, are displayed in environments that actually do not relate to that object in any meaningful way, especially if they're in art galleries and things. The idea of the real is actually a bit of a fiction for us, and that this distinction between the real and the replica is something that we've created. And it's something that needs to be questioned and taken apart.
But could you really do that switch so they start thinking it's better to visit a facsimile than to visit the original? And we've had in Egypt this wonderful opportunity. So at the moment, people can visit both. So we really want them to go to both and look at both and ask themselves that question. And at normal viewing distance, there is no difference. If you start thinking about that, then you start thinking about what you're gaining and what you're losing. This is perhaps a landmark, a watershed, a moment where visiting a facsimile looks and feels the same as it does to visit the original.
I think a project like the Replica Project, which the Griffith was a part of, creates a space that anyone can go into and think about replicas versus originals, what is authentic, what isn't, what do we do when tombs start to deteriorate, what possibilities do we have open to us. And that's not a debate that should be just centred in universities or in academic institutions. It needs to be a public debate. It needs to involve all the communities that have an interest in Egypt.